So welcome everybody again to one of our webinars in the series that probably will be the last for before the vacations, before the holidays, and we will continue in September. So our last talk for the period will be given by Dimitris Christodoulou from the Department of Mathematics, University of Massachusetts. It is a pleasure to have Dimitris with us. He's an expert in several fields, from galactic dynamics to magnetohydrodynamics. Today, we will be speaking about solar system dynamics, planet formation. And we are glad to have your talk, Dimitri.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I wonder if we can blow this up or not.
Sure.
Can we go to a slide show or not? Yeah. Can we also minimize this? Okay. I'm glad to be here. Thank you for having me. It's been 7 years since my last visit. And what I told you back then is that the NIST model for planet migration is completely wrong, but you didn't believe me. And now I brought back more proof, but I'm not going to talk about the NIST model at all. I'm going to give you a very light talk. I was trying to design it to be also for the public. So I'm going to cut out all the mathematics. If you want to see the mathematics, you can look at the archive preprint, and it's all there. I just want to talk about physics today. Even ask some questions that have never been asked before, to which I came by finding the answer first. Nobody's asking some questions because there's no real reason unless you come up with the answer first, and then the answer causes the question. When I got quarantined last year, last March, I knew that I was going to have a lot of problems with isolation. So I figured that since I'm going to be spending a lot of time with myself, I had to find something to do, project that would take my mind elsewhere. And I wouldn't think so much about isolation and COVID. And went back to my favorite subject, the solar system, because all the data is readily available on the internet these days. And I had also a bouncing board. This is Dimos Kazanas, who took, it took me more than a year to convince him that there is some truth to what I'm saying. So here is how it started. I'm going to give you the history of the whole thing, how it developed in the real time, starting March of 2019. As you know, in physics in general, we're doing observations or experiments. We're looking for patterns that develop in those experiments. And the idea is to do pattern recognition and try to learn something about the physical reality out of these patterns. Well, we don't always do it very well. Sometimes we do it well, sometimes we do it terribly. And here is an example. The mean distances of Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune from the sun are 5, 10, 20, and 30. And people looked at these data long ago, and they said, well, this is a geometric progression. You can tell that they were not doing very well because numbers like, forget the 5 of Jupiter. Okay, Jupiter is an additive. Look at 10, 20, 30. Does this look like a geometric progression to you? It doesn't look. Looks like an arithmetic progression. In addition to that, there is also an arithmetic progression in the inner solar system. Mercury, Venus, and Earth are in arithmetic progression. They're not in geometric progression. And this brings into question the famous geometric progression that people, and this is important to question it right now, because people are using it in exoplanets too. And, you know, they say it works. Well, it might, but it doesn't work in the solar system. There is a similar arithmetic progression in the Galilean satellites of Jupiter, Io, Europa, etc. This progression was not discovered by numerologists, so there hasn't been any talk out on the internet about a very similar type of arithmetic progression. That's maybe because the numbers have 2 decimals or something. Numerologists are turned off by it. Anyway, I'm going to get back to these numbers at the very end of the talk, if I ever get there. This project started with me reading the IAU resolutions One of them redefined the word planet, and another one demoted Pluto to a dwarf. I took offense.
Yeah. Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
So what do you mean? What would be a wrong pattern in numerology overall?
Nothing. Numerology is not physics. That's all I was saying.
Exactly.
And they got it wrong.
Vast numerology gets pattern.
Well, you will see. You will see. Okay. That's the reason for the talk. At the end, I'm going to get back to those numbers. And approach them from the point of view of physics, not numerology. I took offense in the IAU declaration solicitation of proposals for a new definition of planet, and I took also offense in the new definition that was voted. I didn't vote in that round. When it came to Pluto, I voted for sentimental reasons. I voted for Pluto, and Pluto lost. I was wrong in my vote. I'm going to tell you now that Pluto was correctly demoted, but I still took offense with the definition. The original announcement was saying that my ancestors, ancient Greeks, didn't know much about these objects. All they saw was the objects moving around in the sky. So they named them planets because they were like wandering around, planets meaning wander and all that. So then they said, well, now we know so much more about these systems, these objects, that we should be able to come up with a better definition. And then, which is fine with me. I mean, if you think you know a lot more, which may not be the case, but if you think you know a lot more, go ahead, use it and make up a new definition. Don't make this atrocity that was voted as the new definition. Here is the problem with the atrocity that is now the new definition. They said the ancients were based solely on the orbits of the planets that they were seeing up in the sky, in order to come up with a definition. We know a lot more. What exactly do you know which is more? Well, you know physical properties. How many of those physical properties did they use? The answer is half, not even one out of three. The new definition says that the object has to go around the sun, that's orbit. It has to have a clear path around the sun, that's orbit. And it has to have a round shape, which is geometry, but you can make some association with physics around shape. So I took offense with this definition, and I knew that they didn't do the right thing. So I said, I'm going to do the right thing. I'm going to start investigating the physical properties of the planets in order to find out what they tell me. And I'm not going to leave it up to the bureaucrats and votes. So I looked at the volume densities, and there is not much here. You can see I'm plotting planets, satellites, asteroids, Kuiper belt objects. Everything is there in this graph, as you can see from the legend. And there is no clear pattern here. There is nothing that will divide. There is no dividing line between the planets and everything else. If there is anything interesting in this figure, the only thing that I found interesting is that we're number one in density in the solar system. Our Earth is the densest object in the solar system. Hey, we're number one for once, but no clear pattern. So we're moving on. And then when you look at surface gravities, the situation, turns dramatic, because what you see is that the planets are sitting at the top of this graph versus distance from the sun, and everything else is below, and there is a huge gap, huge, humongous gap in G, in surface gravity, that separates the planets from everything else. Mercury and Mars have the lowest G. They're twins, as far as the G is concerned. I call them G twins. They have a G of 3.7, more or less. And this is as low as it gets. And since there are no more planets, and there will be no more planets in the solar system, this is the lower boundary of planets. All planets have G, which is more than 3.7. Everything else has G, which is below 1.8. And by the way, the planets are not competing against dwarfs. The biggest G in dwarfs is Eris, with a G of 0.8. So, who is the competition? The competition is large satellites, Io and our own moon, with G's of, this is Io, and this is our moon, with a G's of 1.8 and 1.6, respectively. And this is as close as we can get by using satellites.
So where is Pluto on the diagram?
It's one of those filled dots. It's, it's this one. This is Eris, and this is Pluto. So I saw in this diagram that Mercury and Mars were twins. And then I thought of this old Hollywood movie, Twins, where Arnold Schwarzenegger and Danny DeVito were playing the twins. And of course, that was funny. That was meant to be funny, but well, it was funny, but it didn't stop me from calculating the effective G for each one of them by being a self-gravitating mass. And yeah, the G ratio is about one, just about, yeah. So it's not funny anymore to me to have Danny and Arnold have the same G, surface G. But anyway, there is a huge dividing line. I drew the dividing line in the middle of the gap at 2.7 meters per second squared. If you don't like that because it's a decimal number, draw it at 3. What these data show is that if something, if an object has a G of more than 3, it is definitely a planet. Definitely. And it works for exoplanets too. I tested it. It works very nicely. As much as we know about exoplanets, it works very well. And if it's less than 3, then it's debatable. Dwarf planets have definitely less G of less than 8. They don't even come close to 8. And surprisingly, the large satellites are sitting in the middle. Yeah.
No, but are these numbers reliable?
Oh, yeah, this is known for now, the latest state of the art, yes.
We know so well
that yes, they have been corrected by follow-up observations, yes. Yeah, observations of these objects still go on these days. And yeah, they're very, very reliable.
Pluto is so very different from the others.
Pluto is not very different. It's that's Pluto.
Yeah,
not,
very different from the planets. That's
a... Oh, yes, that's why I said that maybe we did the right thing when we demoted it. It doesn't belong.
This is the effective gravitational acceleration, meaning that I assume
it's a gm of rho squared, yes, effective gravitational acceleration, yes, on the surface of a planet. The little table here on the right, it shows you that Io and Moon are also sisters. They're very similar as moons go. You can see the ratio of their properties. If you exclude the ratio of masses, which is 0.82, everything else is up in the high 90s, 90s and above. They're sisters. Sister moons, and they have the highest G's amongst all moons. Next thing, I looked at diameters, and what you see is another gap in diameters. And I don't know, the gap doesn't show. How come? Oh, it's light blue. There is another gap right here in diameters, around 1,000 kilometers. The only objects that you find are small Kuiper belt objects, but you can forget about that for now. There is a clear separation between satellites, large and small satellites. That's another gift that came from the data. I can define, by using just a single parameter, large and small satellites, and that's the diameter, roughly 1,000 kilometers. Here is a histogram of all the satellites. Well, not all of them, some of them are missing. Some very small ones and some very big ones are missing. And you can see clearly that in the solar system, no moon was created with a diameter between 500 and 1,000 kilometers, roughly speaking. It's a humongous gap. And it clearly separates the few large satellites from the many, many little satellites. And based on the above, the diameters and the G mostly, here is my system of definitions, which is very, very, which very much relies on physical properties. Well, if you exclude satellites, satellites, of course, orbit around larger nearby objects. So I bring in the orbit only for the satellites. For the rest of the stuff, I don't need to know anything about the orbit because I know a lot about the physical properties of these objects. If the G is more than 2.7, it's a planet. If it is less than 2.7 and the diameter is more than 1,000 kilometers, it's a dwarf, and there are 7 of them. And this opens up the road for a possible collaboration between the IAU and Disney. Disney World, we have an opportunity to get into entertainment, maybe sell tickets, because there are only 7 dwarfs in the solar system, according to this breakdown. And then, of course, you have smaller bodies and all that. The new definition, which no one has talked about, is large versus small satellites. I can do it with a diameter, 1,000 kilometers, or I can do it with the G. This is the G that separates large from small satellites. So all large satellites have a G, which is about 0.15 all the way to 1.8 for Io. And the small satellites are below 0.13. a very clear distinction because of the breaks that I see in those diagrams. So I'm going to look for more clues, and I'm going to keep looking at physical properties of those objects. I'm going to stay away from orbital properties. These are the distributions of masses of the satellites of Jupiter, Saturn, and so on. I also put in black a scaled down version of the solar system, but you can safely ignore that. I had to scale down the solar system in order to see if it's more or less the same. What I want you to notice is the four different distributions of mass versus distance from the central object for the satellites of the gaseous giants. And it doesn't take too much looking before you realize that they're extremely similar. The only difference worth mentioning is that for Neptune and for Uranus, there are satellites all the way in 50,000 kilometers from the central object. But Jupiter and Saturn, being like larger planets, did not allow any satellite to survive out to 130 kilometers. And so there is a minor difference there in the inner, but the shapes are very much similar. And to make them even more similar, I just shifted the distributions of Neptune and Uranus by 80,000 kilometers, and you can see now they're almost identical. You don't need statistics to claim that, but well, if I did that, everybody would be on top of me. So I did statistics. And here is an example. This is masses. The Kolmogorov-Smirnov test shows clearly, beyond the shadow of a doubt, that these distributions of satellites come from the same continuous pattern distribution. What this means is, and I want you to take a special note of that, what this means is that the formation mechanism is the same. I'm not saying anything new. They were all made in some kind of accretion disk where the dust settled and all that. But also the evolution was the same because these are the currently observed distributions. So it's not enough to make them from dust and particles and pebbles be the same. The later evolution has to be the same because they end up looking like this today. And here is the mass radius relation. There is a lot more statistics that shows the previous result. Mass radius relation is another spectacular result. I'm plotting masses, and it's 18 to 35, was 17 orders of magnitude in mass, and 6 to 11, 5 orders of magnitude in radius. And what you see is a straight line. It's unbelievable. I fitted that, and the slope of the line is 3, of course. And then I got from the fit, I got the characteristic density, and the density is not 1. When I told Yanis about it, he said, well, isn't it known that there is a characteristic density of 1? Yes, it is from simulations. But what I'm saying now is that the density is not 1. It's 0.5, as you can see. And there is a reason for that. It puts us at a very low density regime of the solar system, where very few objects exist. Most of the objects are made of ice and rock or mixtures of the rain, but there are very, very few objects made with densities less than 1, and they're made of pumice ice, Lafrobitres. And the characteristic freefall time is 47 minutes. What this means, is, to me at least, out of the row that I got, of the density that I got, I can only get one number. And this is the freefall time using the G in gravity. And what this means is that the collapse of each individual object is halted when the dynamical time becomes 47 minutes, about 1 hour. It doesn't matter if it's small, it doesn't matter if it's big. When the dynamical time, when the freefall time hits 47 minutes or about 1 hour, the collapse stops on all of these objects, large and small. And I included the sun. If you look in the upper right corner, you will see the sun. The sun is fitting very well, this distribution. So we're talking about gravitational collapse. I want you to look at the bottom of this diagram where the pumice objects are. They have densities lower than 1. I have the ice line at the density of 1, and I have the rock line as we usually do it. Solar system astronomy, we draw the rock line at 1.5. And these are the Saturn moons, and you can see Saturn has everything. It's an exquisite laboratory, which we can use in order to see everything that is out there. There are pumice objects down below. Tethys is an ice world. You have Mimas and Rhea and Iapetus. Well, Iapetus is almost ice, but you have Mimas and Rhea somewhere in between, a mixture of rock and ice. And then you have the rocky planets like Titan sits at the top, mighty Titan sits at the top. And so everything is there in this system, in Saturn. Not everything is there in the other gaseous, around the other gaseous giants. And all eyes on Hyperion. Hyperion is fearless. It orbits right next to Titan. It orbits Saturn. Titan, mighty Titan, second largest moon in the solar system, has not been able to knock it off of its orbit and like throw it away. The reason is that, of course, Hyperion is protected by a 4-3 mean motion resonance, and we will get to resonances. The price that Hyperion pays in this safe orbit is that its rotation is completely random. Even the axis moves around. You never know. You cannot predict how it's going to tumble around its orbit. It was called like a sponge, and this is a mistake. It's a clear mistake, because the sponges that I know, at least, don't have caverns that go from one side to the other. It is not a sponge. It is a pumice. The black, many of the black spots that you see are openings, caverns, that go all the way to the other end. The density of the main diameter is about 270 kilometers, but the density of the thing is only 0.5. I also put down the principal axis. You can see the principal axis here. I did that because after they give these numbers, it is like a conspiracy to me. After they give those numbers out in different places on the internet, they never miss to say that the shape is irregular. And I'm telling you, it's not irregular. It's a triaxial ellipsoid, very nice, considering what's happening to it. What I want you to notice is that there is those funnels or some chimneys. In many of the hits, there are chimneys, and there is like a ridge of chimneys out here. And you know, there are craters, of course, but then of course it looks like if you think that this is the bottom of the crater, that cannot be, because the whole thing is asymmetric. You can see the fragment hit here, and then the black thing here is not really at the center of the crater. So anyway, there are like big chimneys and stuff, and it shows that this thing is just a pumice stone, and there are caverns that go straight through the interior. So what is important about this object and other little objects like that is that it is not supported by isotropic pressure. And that's why it's not a sphere exactly. It's actually a miracle that it looks like more or less like an ellipsoid, because it is supported only by stresses, by mechanical stresses in the walls of the caverns. And here is an example, a contradistinction between fearless Hyperion with all of its caverns and stuff, and Phoebe. Phoebe is rock. Its density is above 1.5, and it is battered rock. It has been battered all over the place, and you can see none of the interesting features of Hyperion exist here. Also, if you look inside the craters, you will see that the shadows that you see in the craters are very much symmetric, sitting in the center of the craters. They're not like the little black dots that you see in the other place. So this made me think about pumice stones on Earth. So I started looking for a pumice. Last time I held a pumice, I was maybe 80 years old. And I thought I was very impressed by the fact that the thing didn't weigh anything. So I started looking for a pumice stone, like the one I had when I was 8 years old, and I couldn't find one. These days, they work on pumice and they make it in the shape of fishes and stuff like that. So I didn't want that. I wanted like an irregular type of shape. And I found one. Oh, and I took a close-up. This is a pumice stone that I bought and took a close-up just to show you another chimney here and another one maybe here, a cavern here. And you can see the feature, it looks very much the same like the ones that we see in Hyperion. And this is the pumice stone, and I'll give it to you. I bought it from Honda Center. It goes for less than €2. And the close-up that you see comes from this pumice stone. It's extremely light. There are a lot of caverns that are completely empty on the interior. I managed to find one. I was very proud to find one at Hondo Center. So we're gonna look a little bit more at the rock, ice, and pumice objects in the solar system. Here is a histogram where I'm spreading a little bit the densities. And yes?
Pumice, if I recall, has a very different formation history from rocks.
Well, in our case, we get it from volcanic deposits.
Explosions.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know how it got there, but it was there. Well, I don't think there were any volcanoes. The material was there as pebbles and stuff, pebbles of pumice or something. It came together. I don't know how. But the low densities.
The formation of this chain has a very violent formation history.
Yeah, definitely. 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 Yeah. So look at the Jupiter's moons. There are some pumice moons inside, and then you have the Galilean satellites, and then you have the outer rocky type of moons, little moons on the outside. And this is a beautiful arrangement. The Galilean satellites are all together, and then on one side they have some minor pumice moons, and then far out, where the tidal forces could not really actually reach, you have those rocky little moons that survived. A very regular situation. Nothing that you would expect from a chaotic evolution where a rock was pounding rock and sometimes, you know, dissolving rock, sometimes sticking together and all that to create protocores. Saturn, a superb laboratory. It has everything. It has pumice moons and Hyperion too, our hero. It's got ice moons. It's got dirty ice moons like Mimas and Rhea. And it's got rocky moons like Titan and Phoebe and all those. An excellent laboratory. And there is always a gap. As you can see, there is a gap between the inner satellites and the outermost satellites. There's always a huge gap and it repeats everywhere around the planets, the gas giants. And this is the distribution of objects in the Kuiper belt. And the first thing to notice is that there is no pumice, no substantial amounts. I did find with difficulty two objects that may be pumice, but the densities are highly uncertain. There is no dirty ice either. These objects, either they have a density of one, they're like pure ice, or they have a density of 1.5 or more, they're like pure rock. And I plotted here the satellites of Saturn, our excellent laboratory, along with the Kuiper belt objects. I put them all in the same plot. And what you see is, of course, you see the lines of rock, ice, separating everything and separating pumice. And then you see the G equals 0.13 line. What I want you to notice is Enceladus, EN, and Tethys. These are two satellites of Saturn. One of them has a G of 0.15 and the other one has a G of 0.11. And they are sitting on either side of the dividing line that I was telling you in G, between large and small satellites. Tethys is large, Enceladus is small, according to my definition. And I also marked Logos, an icy little object. It's a binary object, it's called Logozoi. And I also marked Mimas here. They are important. Mimas is the smallest moon with a perfectly round shape. So somebody wanted to put in an arbitrary line and say that if the thing is more than 400 kilometers and it's round, it has to be that category or that category. I don't think this is the case. The frame down below shows you the binary Logozoi. And this is the Hubble Space Telescope looking at this tiny little binary system. And this is the best we can do with the Hubble. Maybe in the near future we'll be able to do very well. But it doesn't look to me that this is irregular. Logos is irregular. As far as I can tell, I know that it's low resolution. Best we can do, it's only 77 kilometers and it's around, as far as I can tell. So trying to draw arbitrary lines in the diameters is not gonna do it. The only line that is justified is 1,000 kilometers that I showed you, where no satellite was made, but other objects in the Kuiper belt were made. So I'm gonna show you just now a comparison in the architecture of all those different systems. Tolkien talked about this thing long ago. That's what we're talking about too now, what Tolkien was saying back in 1925. one thing to rule them all, and in the darkness bind them. That's what we're headed to. Well, he decided to do literature rather than physics, so he changed the word thing to ring, and then, you know the rest of the history. Cookie cutter satellite systems. Not only were they formed by the same physical process, they had the exact same evolution too. Jupiter on the left, Uranus on the right. You got like some big guys, all of them together, you have a gap, and then you have like the outermost satellites. Himalaya in Jupiter has a companion, Themisto. Little Themisto is a friend of Himalaya. And because the resonance is 18 to 1, it's a very high order resonance, 18 to 1. There is a suspicion that Himalaya is not 35 to 1, which is the best thing that I made, it's 36 to 1. What you see in these diagrams, along with the similarity in the different objects, you are seeing the global resonances of those systems because everything is on or near resonance. Everything, global resonance. We'll get back to this soon. When the numbers get very big, when the order of the resonance gets very big, there are many possible locations that you could assign to those objects because they're kind of closely together and all that. That's what happens with Himalaya. The 35 to 1 is the absolutely lowest error that you can find, but if you place it to 36 to 1, it's still a very acceptable fit. And Themisto, which is a smaller number, indicates that this might be the case because these two are in 1 to 2 local resonance, 18 to 36. Notice that, who is that? Ariel. Ariel is not, is in a 2 to 7 resonance, so none of the numbers is 1. I call that a principal resonance. If it's one over something or something over one, I will call this a principal resonance as opposed to a fractional resonance. Some fractional resonances exist and they're important. We continue with the others now. Saturn and Neptune. Neptune is a broken cookie. It came out of the same cookie cutter, but the cookie is broken because Triton came in and obliterated the entire satellite system. The only survivors are a couple of little, like maybe 2 or 3 or 4 moons on the interior. And these survived. And then Nereid is also a capsule satellite. It's not a natural satellite of Neptune. So it's a shattered cookie. It's a broken cookie. And, but still, the arrangement is pretty much the same as in the other three gas giants. And on the left, you see again, Brave Hyperion. I blew up the circle. It is, I tried to use a logarithmic scale for the sizes, the circles are sizes, but then I couldn't show more than a dot for the little ones, so I blew them up artificially. So when you see a Hyperion or Kivyuk or Nereid being so big, it's artificial. I wanted to blow them up to show you that they exist. You also see surface gravities, you see densities. If the density is written in black, it's rock. If it's written in blue, it's ice. And if it's written in brown, it's pumice. And here is a final comparison. On the left, you see the systems of satellites of the four gaseous giants, exactly as they orbit around the sun. In the other frame, I shifted everything to the same distance, just to show you how much they look if you take away the initial gap. How much they look the same. They're extremely the same. They're absolutely the same. The only substantial difference is that in Neptune, Triton does not have a near neighbor on the outside. Triton obliterated everything. Don't expect too much from it. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about mean motion resonances that showed up in the previous diagram. And then, of course, about Landau's dumping. Because that's also a necessary part of the mechanism, of the cookie cutter mechanism. All right, I'm gonna talk about global MMRs. I'm not gonna look at two different objects and try to divide their periods and get this. I'm gonna look at all the objects and I'm gonna lay down the resonances, the global mean motion resonances of the most major object. Like in the solar system, the most major object is Jupiter. Like it or not, it's Jupiter. So I'm gonna lay down the global mean motion resonances of Jupiter, and I'm gonna look where all the other planets are. And I'm gonna do the same thing with the satellite system of Jupiter and so on and so on. I'm gonna do it with Mars. Mars has two satellites. And if I'm going to leave an impression on you that something from what I say is correct, I have to be able to fit Mars with only two of them. And I cannot play the same game with our moon. So let's start with Jupiter's global MMRs in the solar system. Jupiter is 1-to-1. If you find Jupiter, the mean motion resonance is 1-to-1. And there is no error associated with it because I chose it. And you can see where everything else falls. Everything is near a mean motion resonance of Jupiter, everything. Some of them who are approved by numerologists over the years, and people do talk about them, you can find them on the internet. For example, they tell you that, where is it? Neptune to Pluto is in a 3-to-2. Yeah, but they will tell you that Saturn is not in mean motion resonance with Jupiter because it's close to 5-to-2, but according to numerologists, it's not close enough. This is the numerology game that people play, and it was thoroughly entertaining reading the literature and finding all the rules that they were making up, you know, on a day that they slept well and they had bright ideas. I'm gonna talk about those numbers, not from the rules, but from the point of view of physics. There is a reason that these things are arranged here, and there is a physical reason. It is important to realize that Saturn sits in 5-to-2 and the 2-to-1 is empty in the solar system. 2-to-1 exterior, outside of Jupiter is empty. You can see also some asteroids. I'm doing the best I can with asteroids. And you can see like the Kuiper belt objects here. As the numbers go very big, like Eris, for example, you can put Eris 47-to-1 or 48-to-1 and it will still be good. And the outermost dwarf planet, in the solar system is Sedna. Sedna sleeps at a period of 11,400 years in the outer solar system. And the mean motion resonance is close to 1,000-to-1. I find this very funny. We're moving on to Jupiter's system, the Galilean satellites and everything. Ganymede is on 1-to-1, and you can see all the other resonances. There are more little ones beyond Himalaya, but I didn't put them down. Io, Europa, and Ganymede are locked into the famous Laplace resonance. Everybody knows about that. Everybody admits that this is a resonance. But Callisto, which is the second largest moon after Ganymede, and almost as big as Ganymede, is not sitting in the 2-to-1. It's not locked in the Laplace resonance. It wasn't accepted as a member of the group. It sits at 7-to-3. Why is that? Because 2-to-1 is forbidden. It looks like 2-to-1 is forbidden. It could not have settled. Even if it tried to get into 2-to-1, which would be the natural evolution, as I'm about to tell you, it was knocked out in a way by Ganymede. Triton, this, you know, a system that has been obliterated by Triton. Here is what survived. Some inner moons survive in some resonances, not so bad, but you can see the whole thing is disturbed. The relative errors are like 5 or 6% now. No more 1 or 2%, like 5 and 6 and all that. And there is like a, oh, this is on the interior. And there are some of the exterior too, not so disturbed. It's the interior system that is kind of disturbed. There is a little moon that's called Larissa. This is my favorite because I was born in a town that's called Larissa, but this is Larissa Earth, not Larissa Neptune. And I have to say this, Larissa was a nymph in Thessaly, and we have coins that date all the way back to 410 before Christ. And in one of these coins, you can see how Larissa used to look like, typical Greek nose and everything. And on the back, we have the emblem of the soccer team. In Larissa, it's a horse. Our tradition with horses dates back to 400 before Christ, so we had to use it for soccer emblems too. Moving on to Pluto. Pluto has the most beautiful satellite system. It has no gaps at all, except the 2-to-1, which is forbidden. It's beautiful. And Disney animators seem to know about that many, many years ago. Look at the cartoon. And what you will see is that they left the 2-to-1 empty. They knew, they must have known about this. They must have. So I'm coming second into this. The word beautiful is not misspelled. It's in honor of a movie that's called Beautiful. Maybe you should see it. It's a very high quality drama. And the kid asks the father, who is Latino, trying to learn English, and says, how do you spell the word beautiful? And his father, without missing a breath, he said this, beautiful. Ah, it's easy to spell this. Anyway, I mean, it's kind of amazing. I mean, all the positions are full, all the principal residences are full, and then 2-to-1 is empty. You know, amazing. 1, 3, 4, 5, 6. Look at that. And finally, in the Martian system, no one has ever said that Deimos is in 4-to-1 resonance, not our Deimos, the moon Deimos. I don't know if Deimos joined in. It's like 4 o'clock out there, right? The satellite that is known as Deimos with EI is in a precise 4-to-1 resonance with Phobos, exact. Doesn't get any better than this. The difference from the exact resonance is 18 minutes in the orbit, 18 minutes. No one has said that there is a 4-to-1 resonance. You heard it here first. And my conclusion is this, the threat of coincidence. It goes against pattern and impedes recognition. So let's talk physics now. What happened here? Well, what happened is that all the major objects in the solar system, either planets in the disk of the solar system or satellites, they were formed by accident here and there, wherever the protocores managed to agglomerate and become big, and then they started moving toward one another, exchanging angular momentum, obliterating every little piece of rock in the process. That's why there is nothing there between them. You will not find any place in the solar system where a little guy is between the big guys. Nowhere. Only Hyperion was caught in 4-to-3, but it's not between the guys. It's off to one side. And I looked at the exoplanets. I'm, of course, working with exoplanets. There is one or two very weird objects who are like an Earth type of object, sits between two Jupiters. We will see how this is made. They're extremely scarce. The vast majority of exoplanets obey the same rule. So what this means is that there is a mechanism after formation that brings them together. And this mechanism is called angular momentum exchanges. And where are they going? Where are they headed? The answer is I do have a new interesting point or critical point in the solar system, and this is n bar. It's the average, the mean, of the mean motion of the objects in the solar system, n bar. Mean motions meaning angular velocities. It's a very interesting place. We're going to skip the math that shows that the objects are moving toward one another. So two bodies, if you let them exchange angular momentum, they will come close to one another. Three bodies, the inner one is coming out, it's gaining angular momentum, the inner one is coming in, and the third one does whatever. Here, the third one was started on N bar, on the orbit N bar, so it doesn't want to go anywhere for a long time until the red guy comes close and pulls angular momentum from it. Or gives it, or whatever. So Ln bar is the angular momentum that corresponds to the orbit n bar. The stable, well, it's a stable, well, it's unstable, but it's sort of like an equilibrium position, but it's unstable. 4 and 5 bodies. In 5 bodies, look at the green orbit. I started it with an angular momentum exactly at Ln bar, and look, it stayed forever. That's because these two guys started exchanging a lot more angular momentum coming together. And this way, maybe a little bit, but this guy didn't move anywhere. It started on an unstable equilibrium and stayed there for quite a long time, yes.
You assume that everything moves in the same plane.
Yes, of course.
If there's a slight inclination, will they come together?
I don't know, but Well, yeah, we're going to project the angular momentum.
I wanted to ask that before. You said,
well,
they completely, as they
1 or 2 degrees, you think is going to make a difference? Maybe.
Move, as they move together, you said they completely obliterate the small guys in between.
Yeah.
But assuming that they're in the same plane, so if it's one.
Yes, yes, of course. Yeah, 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 yes, yes, yes. The little guys were not thrown physically out of the system. They were thrown out by tidal forces, basically. So it doesn't matter what the inclination is. I mean, the tides are going to get you. And by the way, the reason that we have like such a nice situation, easygoing situation right now in the solar system is that there is no tidal field. There are no tides in the solar system right now. The tidal field was gone long before we had the chance to study it. And I'm going to tell you about it.
Sure.
This is where this thing is headed, to the tidal field.
Here's the question.
Yes.
I do understand and agree that there are no tidal forces, not much of them.
Yeah.
What about the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter?
Yeah. What about?
What about it? I mean, this has been, maybe they clear, Jupiter obviously cleared the path, but there seems to be.
Well, they still collide, right? I mean, this is like a small local phenomenon. They still collide with one another sometimes.
Something is between the terrestrial planets and the giant gas planets. Because there is clear physical difference in there between the two types of planets and you have the asteroid belt in between.
Yes, the asteroid belt was not made into a planet, right? Because of Jupiter stirring and all that. But right now, I think there are strong tidal forces between those objects. They happen to come close enough. Yeah, I mean, I'm not talking about those. I'm talking about the major objects. When I say like the biggest ones, they're all together. There is 6 of them in Saturn. There is 4 of them, the Galileans, in Jupiter. They're all clustering together with no little object in between. That's what I meant. This evolution is unphysical, and I'm going to skip it. I did it just for fun. Once they start colliding, the exchange of angular momentum depends on the time step that I choose or how close they will get together. It's unphysical, but it's still fun. It is still fun to do. And 6 bodies, you can see all the interactions and changes of angular momentum. But once they collide, it's all unphysical. It never happened in the solar system. It never happened. That's what happened in the solar system. You know, they started getting closer and closer together. And then, of course, the tidal field went away. We will see how. And they found themselves orbiting or near the circular orbits with no tidal forces. And they have been there ever since for us to observe, waiting for us to observe. So there were no interactions and collisions between orbits. So once you decide that the angular momentum exchanges will bring those major objects together, and this is a calculation that I did not do first. Papaluizu did it, and then he arrived at the wrong conclusion. Papaluizu had made up his mind even before he did the calculation. He wanted to show that the satellites behave just like an accretion disk. So the orbits will spread out and away from what? I don't know what, but he had made up his mind. So although he derived the correct equation, he didn't look at the angular momentums. He started looking at the energies, and of course he came up with the wrong conclusion, the one that he wanted to find. I redid the calculation in 2 different ways, and I found the opposite conclusion. Moons are not like accretion disks. They don't spread. They cluster together. And once you decide that this is correct, and these guys are like clustering together, the orbits are clustering together, you have to find a mechanism to stop this, because apparently in our solar system, this thing ended before any collisions and, you know, havoc was created. And of course, there is such a mechanism, and we have Lev Landau to thank. It's called Landau damping. It's famous in plasma physics, and not only in plasma physics. People who were doing stellar systems realized that when you're doing like a stellar system in a galaxy, you have at least 10 to the 10 stars to work with, big enough number, not as big as Avogadro's number, but big enough. So they said, oh yeah, we might have Landau dumping like in stellar systems. All I do today is I come to you to tell you yes, but everything is good. Landau in stellar systems, Landau dumping. But Landau dumping can happen also between moons and planets. Even if you have 3 or 4 or 5 of them. There is nothing in the mechanism that demands that you have 10 to the 23 particles or 10 to the 10 particles. You can do it with 3 particles if you have to. The usual way of explaining Landau dumping is with a surfer. You have a wave and the surfer is riding the wave, and if the surfer is like in front of the wave is pushing on the surfer, and the wave loses energy. And the surfer keeps traveling nicely and all that. And on the other frame, you have a boat, and it's a wise move to draw a boat, because if you draw a surfer on the back of the wave, then the surfer is pushing the wave because it's trying to move faster, loses energy, and goes down to the bottom of the potential. So what they did in this cartoon, they said, okay, I'm gonna draw a boat and I'm gonna have the boat going full engines, in which case it can stay where you see it by expending a lot of energy because it gives energy to the wave. So that is a cartoon type of explanation of Landau's damping. The situation is more complicated, and they even did Maxwellian statistics and stuff, but I don't need Maxwellian statistics because I'm working with 4, 5, and 6 objects. What I want to show you is motion in the tidal field, bouncing body. It's like a surfer here. And you can see that this thing is like surfing, and the wave is like pushing the mass M, and mass M detaches from the wave and falls into the bottom of the potential. And then, you know, it can roll, it has enough energy to roll back up and then back down and all that into this. This is all done in the frame of the wave. The wave is moving with the phase velocity. So as far as the skateboarder or the mass M is concerned, there are two levitation points. This is a stable levitation point, and this is an unstable levitation point. If the mass manages to get there, it can just levitate. It doesn't give energy to the wave, and it doesn't lose to the, you know. But the only stable point is, of course, at the bottom of the potential. And all objects in the solar system that I was talking about, they were going back and forth in those potential minima. And this explains really how the tidal field was gone, because once these guys were all close to the potential minima, especially the biggest ones, once Jupiter and Saturn, for example, in the solar system were like really close to the potential minima, they stop creating the tidal field. They stop being participants in the tidal field. So the tidal field gets weakened a lot. The rest of the objects are still trying to organize the tidal field, but it's so much weaker than before. And as they get close to the potential minima, everybody bails out of the tidal field, and the tidal field is gone, exactly like it happens with free electrons in plasma, and exactly as it happens with stellar systems. No difference. So I'm gonna close with some numerology that is driven by physics. Here's what I learned out of all of this, Landau damping and all that. There is a characteristic wavelength in which those things are allowed to relax. I'm not talking about mean motion resonances. That was some kind of arrangement that they were trying to create, and they did some of them, in periods, in orbital periods. I'm talking about physical, natural wavelength. There is something that's called the Debye length in Landau damping. And the Debye length is the region around which an electron controls everything, doesn't let another electron come in. There is something similar in astrophysics, in the solar system physics. It's called the Hill sphere. Hill sphere is the sphere of influence of a particular planet or satellite. So the Hill length radius gave me a wavelength, a characteristic wavelength. And then I doubled that. The 2.25, I doubled it, and I made it 4.5, because two objects cannot sit in the same potential. They would collide. So the best you can do is, if one of them is like occupying one potential minimum, rocking back and forth, the other has to be on the outside, provided that this other outside is outside also the, you know, the Hill radius. So the characteristic separation S for the solar system is 4.5 AU, 4.5, write it down, please. And for the Galilean satellites is 0.4. These numbers are, you know, very high approximations. So let's go back to the solar system as we know it, the geometric progression that you saw before. I look to see how many wavelengths one object is away from the other. And these are the wavelength numbers, like 2 wavelengths away, and 6 and 11. And which means that if I look at the wavelengths, the wavelengths predict 9.7, 18.7, 30.0 compared to the actual observed values. The agreement is astonishing. So not only are they in an approximate arithmetic progression, they're exactly where they're supposed to be. There are, of course, many wavelengths that are empty. Nothing got in there. There was always room for something to get in there, but nothing made it, because when they were moving toward one another, tidal forces were extremely strong. No one managed to hide in some sort of resonance. Nothing managed to hide. I gave this talk in Lowell, April's Fool's Day, and that's why the comment that you see, that the numbers are exact by astronomical standards, they're not just good enough. And of course, now we go to the satellites of Jupiter, the Galileans. Again, we're playing the same game here. And what you see is, of course, it's a 0.4, exactly as predicted by the Hill radius between them. The only one that is kind of a little bit off is Io. Io is not sitting well inside. It's sitting at 0.42, which is only 0.25 away from Europa. And this is only, well, 3.25 wavelengths, but there is no overlap because Io and Europa are small moons by all standards. So being in that location, the Hill spheres do not overlap. There is no overlap in the Hill sphere, so they're fine. They're safe. It might be that the Laplace resonance played a role here in the system because, you know, maybe it's the Laplace resonance that kept Io in that particular location. It's a triple resonance and all that. That's it. And I'm going to close with, in the words of our latest famous Nobel Prize winner poet, Bob Dylan, Eden is burning. This goes for the coronavirus. And may you stay healthy forever and safe.
Okay, so here is time for questions, first from the audience. Is there anybody who wants to ask something?
I'm just showing my appearance, model.
Can we tell anything about the time of formation?
Yeah, I can tell you something. Not very much, but I can tell you something. I calculated the dissipation timescale, which we all knew that it was going to be much longer than the dynamical time. And I did the calculation based on the Reynolds numbers and stuff, best I could do, applicable to the solar system and all that. And the surprise was that the dissipation timescale goes like the square root of Q. Q is this factor, this usually very big number in the solar system, was invented by McDonald back in 1972. Q is a ratio of two energies in the tidal deformed planet that has bulges and stuff. And Goldreich used it a lot, trying to understand really the deformation and the, you know, the tidal energy exchange, tidal dissipation in the planets. He was calculating masses of bulges and energies in the bulges and all that. And he parameterized his calculations with this Q, which is a very big number. It's like 10 to the 5, I think, for Jupiter and Saturn. It's a little bit smaller for planets like the Earth. And it's a big number. And I was expecting to begin with that the space time scale will be proportional to Q, right? To drive the time scale to a very big number. Well, it's proportional to square root of Q, which remedies the situation. It gives you more than enough time to make the approach, the clustering of those objects. We're not gonna run out of time. It happened early on, believe it or not. There is plenty of time. Of course, you need to knock out about 100 mega years for the protostellar disk to dissipate or accrete into the central object, and then the history of those things begins. It's less than 100 mega years. So after the first 100 mega years, things happened. The gaseous disk had been cleared. And again, the surprise is that it goes like the square root of Q. It makes the 10 to the 6 or something and makes it only 1,000. You lose three zeros right there in the square root.
So the gas giants tend to have dozens of satellites. For example, Jupiter has like 8 million satellites. And I was wondering whether you did any outlier analysis to see, within those 8 satellites, before
you
see 5 or 10.
There are no outliers. What I did is, I think I wrote it in the paper that I considered all of them above 5 kilometers diameter, all of them. And I put them in my graphs and stuff. It's everything is there.
Fair enough. I mean, they are above 5 kilometers diameter, so they go lady. Otherwise, they would be very hardly discoverable, I guess.
Well, yeah, the idea was that if something is in the outer disk of Jupiter, if something is going to be resonance, it would be something that is like 20 kilometers in size, not something that is 3 or 1. And I always included the last one. In those systems, there is always one that's very far away, like a tiny little thing, but I always consider that to see, in other words, how far out the resonances go.
Okay.
I didn't pick and choose, though. That's the important thing. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Well, yes, obviously. Studying 80 satellites would be a hard thing to do, but I was just wondering whether you just statistically look for any outliers in there. Is there one?
No, I didn't. Okay. For the small things, yes, I didn't care where they are.
Okay.
It's true though, that if the tidal field develops because of the 4 or 5 extremely massive satellites, like the Galileans, or the 5 or 6 in Saturn, this tidal field would have a lot of difficulty getting all the way out there in the outer disk and perturbing them. Maybe stirring them a little bit, yes, but not ejecting them. So it makes sense to me that all 4 of them have these outer regions with lots of little pebbles and rocks and like we call moons. It makes sense. The tidal field was developed, in the inner region and couldn't get very well there just to clear it out. But it did clear a gap. The outer gap that I was showing on the outside of those major planets, there is always a gap. And this must have been cleared by them, by the tidal field. Iapetus is the only moon that sits inside that gap. And it's a very lucky one. It sits in a precise 5-to-1 resonance. It found safety in that resonance. Otherwise, we'll be knocked out too.
Right there, yeah.
Okay, let's see. Anyone who wants to ask something from you outside here, raise your hand or.
Oh, they're muted, so I can't ask anything.
No. They are not muted. They can unmute themselves if they want. Okay. They're unmuted from us, right? It's okay. Okay then. Okay, there are not enough data from these extraplanetary systems that are discovered now to check.
I started working with 2 undergrad students.
Okay.
Basically on extraplanets, because this is not a very difficult job. I mean, you can get even undergraduates into projects
And
they might even be fun,
Yeah.
And there are a lot of resonances in the exoplanets. And we already have systems in which also the wavelength works, not only the resonance, the wavelengths, the way that I was describing.
Yeah.
Because again, if it's a tidal field, you need both.
Exactly. Yeah,
you need both, to adjust the periods and you need to adjust the wavelengths.
So
we're working and we're planning to present the results. It will be fun.
Great.
To do.
So I don't see anyone else raising hands. So then in that case, let's thank the speaker again.
Thank you for having me.